opinions, options, answers. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Welcome to Psychiatry, Ask the Expert, hosted by Dr. Neil Kaye. All comments, views, and opinions expressed are solely those of the hosts, guests, and callers. Dr. Kaye will not diagnose or treat callers. The information provided is informational in nature. In the next hour, Dr. Kaye explores the inner workings of the brain and mind. Grab a pen and paper and sit back. Here is your host, Dr. Neil Kaye.
Good evening. Welcome to Psychiatry Ask the Expert. I'm Dr. Neil Kaye, my co-host Jay Birch, and our guest tonight, Dr. Ranga N. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you, and hopefully we'll have a good show tonight.
Hi out there. We're looking forward to tonight's show. The topic is schizophrenia.
And each week on Psychiatry Ask the Expert, we focus on a specific topic in psychiatry. We talk about the disease or illness itself, the common symptoms and presentation of each illness, and, of course, treatment options with a focus on psychopharmacology, meaning medication treatment. We talk about medication risks and benefits, side effects, dosing alternatives, when and how to find the best medication and doctors. Tonight, we're honored to have a friend and colleague, Dr. Ranga N, with us tonight. Dr. Ram is the vice chairman of the Department of Psychiatry for Christiana Care Health System, a former researcher at the University of Maryland on numerous National Institute of Mental Health-funded schizophrenia research grants, former director of mental health for the state of Delaware, and we're going to be discussing schizophrenia with Dr. Ram, a real expert in this area and a serious clinician. We'll talk about schizophrenia, a serious chronic mental illness, and the evidence base behind its treatment. Welcome, Dr. Ram.
Hi, Neil and Jay. It's great to be here. Very glad that you're giving a chance for me to talk about schizophrenia, which is a major brain disorder affecting close to 2.5 million Americans.
Great, Ranga, good to be here. Listeners, our call-in number tonight has been changed. We're going to be using 480-643-5428. We'll take calls at any time, of course, on any topic in mental health, and especially on schizophrenia tonight.
Neil, let's go to our on my radar segment, and just to remind the listeners that it's in this segment where Neil and I discuss recent articles or newspaper clippings from the past week or so that are relative to mental illness topics. We would invite callers, if you have some local news items, to call in and ask for our opinions or to cite those as well. So, Neil, what's on your radar screen this week?
Two things on my radar screen this week. The FDA's recent decision to put yet one more black box warning on medication. At this point, virtually every drug in psychiatry now has at least one of these black box warnings, and to some degree that's diluted the real purpose of them, because now that all of the medicines have them, they all seem to look the same. The evidence base behind this recent decision has been criticized by an awful lot of people as being not really there, and this decision seems somewhat more political than research and evidence based. And I know Dr. Ram and I tonight are going to try to stick to the research and evidence base that we usually like to cite. And so there's been a lot of controversy about that. Obviously, anytime the FDA does this, it serves as another hurdle for people to get treatment. It frightens the public. And certainly we want to be careful with medicines. They're serious. They can have potential short-term and long-term side effects. And we take those seriously, but we also don't want to scare people away from getting treatment that might be important or even life-saving. The other one on my radar is something called the Kaye trial, which we'll be talking about tonight. This is the National Institute of Mental Health-funded five-way study of new antipsychotics, and they actually did compare these drugs to one of the older drugs. Some people have said in the press that the conclusions are that the new drugs and the old drugs are the same. It's just that the new drugs cost a lot more money and are arguing to restrict formularies and access for patients with serious mental illness, knowing that they might not be able to advocate for themselves and trying to just save money for the state at really an expense to the patient. The study did not say that. The study showed significant differences in these medications, and it did not show that the older ones are just as safe or just as effective. even though some of the legislators who didn't really study the article but may have just read the abstract or a newspaper story about the abstract about something else might want to try to spin that their way. So two important issues on my side. What have you come up with this week?
Neil, before I look at my articles, why don't you take just a brief minute here and let the audience know what is the significance of an FDA black box warning versus, say, bold lettering on a package insert, which, as you know, are the guidelines governing the prescribing of any medication.
Sure. The FDA has a variety of ways to notify physicians and the public as well about concerns or potential concerns. I like to underline potential with medications. They put these on the package insert, and then the PDR, the physician's desk reference that everybody seems to refer to, is really a compilation, a collection of all of these package inserts. They can tell us that something might be a concern, raise an issue or question, and want us to be aware of it. And when they do that, they usually will tell us, or if they really want us to be extra aware of it, they can put it in bold letters to draw our eye, our attention to it. The next level up would be to go to a black box. That is, at the beginning of the drug's name, they put in a big black box, all in bold, saying, doctor, beware that this is a problem. This drug increases the risk of suicide or stroke or heart attack or things like that. And it serves as an extra warning. Above that, there's actually a red box, which is, doc, this drug is really dangerous and has high toxicity and lethality. And actually, you see that on drugs that are used to treat cancer because they're designed to kill cells. The other thing the FDA can do is they can issue a mandate. That is, they can say, doc, we want you to do certain things in order to assure safety. We want you to get certain blood tests or labs, or you can only prescribe this drug for so long or at such a dose if they want to do that. And the FDA tends to be pretty conservative about the mandate side, relying mostly on physician judgment and standard of care to set these rules. So that's a little bit more on the boxing. What's on the radar?
On my radar, because today is Valentine's Day, I happen to read, well, not because I happen to read the Wall Street Journal because it's Valentine's Day, but in today's Wall Street Journal, in the Health Journal section of the Wall Street Journal is an article entitled, Where is the Love? Antidepressants May Inadvertently Blunt Feelings of Romance. This actually, you know, ties into a discussion we had several weeks ago when we were talking about depression and the use of the serotonin reuptake inhibitors and how sexual dysfunction became a pretty widespread side effect as these medications became more popular. What this article is referring to is new research, which actually the researchers are looking to find out, do these antidepressants actually blunt the person's interest in sex and interfere with a relationship, a romance, a marriage, for example, to the extent that people on antidepressants in a otherwise happy marriage may not feel that they love their partner anymore, may end up getting divorced. So I think this is an interesting turn of events here for the antidepressant market.
Comment on that strikes me first, of course, the famous medical journal there, the Wall Street Journal, has confused sex and romance. So we can tell this article most likely was written by a man and not by a female, so we'll add that into the mix as we try to interpret this. And part of Valentine's Day, of course, is we all want chocolate, right? Well, chocolate gives us norepinephrine and phenylethanolamine, two of the good chemicals that help. Yes, you can get sexual side effects with SSRIs, but they don't necessarily diminish your ability to feel as long as you're not taking too high a dose. If you take more than you need, you actually can blunt emotional response, particularly in a long-term use. So there might be some concern about it, but I wouldn't get overly out of line about it. And, of course, people don't feel real loving and cuddly when they're depressed and irritable, and most people would rather have their spouse in a normal mood state rather than significantly depressed. Anything else on the radar here?
Yes. You know, I've got two more. Both tie into tonight's topic, and I'm just going to highlight them, and then we'll discuss them with Dr. Romp right after the break, I imagine. My first one on the radar screen comes from the February 6th issue of Newsweek. It's a one-page more or less an editorial, but it's written by a Jay Nugent-Boren, and it's entitled Meds Alone Couldn't Bring Robert Back. And there's an interesting part of this article is the author describes his brother Robert's hospitalization back in 1998 in the New York Psychiatric Institute somewhere in the state, and his physicians describe Robert as probably never being able to live without supervision, and if discharged, was destined to be repeatedly hospitalized. His brother had been in this the hospital system in and out for 40 years, had been on a whole variety of antipsychotics, was started on one of the newer antipsychotics, and had a remarkable response, was in the process of being discharged, and then called one day to say that he was having psychotic symptoms and just everything had all fallen apart. And it turns out that Robert's social worker had been transferred from one hospital where Robert was to another one, and Robert had lost this relationship. So what we're going to discuss with Dr. Rahm is that how important are the other services that are offered to patients with schizophrenia, not just the medications, but the other support services. And my second article comes from, again, my favorite medical journal, the Wall Street Journal, and it's from the February 1st issue. And it talks about the forced care of schizophrenics, and this is a pattern or a philosophy that is fostered by a Dr. E. Fuller-Torrey, where patients with schizophrenia are more or less forced by the state to comply with their medication regimens, or they are imprisoned. And the whole goal of this is to prevent violent outbreaks and just bad things from happening to either the patient or the population in general because of patient with schizophrenia was unmedicated. So those are two topics for our further discussion. Neil, you want to take us to the break?
Yeah, quick comment before we go to break on both of those. The first one, absolutely, medication alone is not the answer, never has been for anything. And each week when we talk about treatment, we are always sure to say medication alone not enough, often necessary but not sufficient to get good outcomes in the illnesses that we're talking about. The second article you have, essentially what we call involuntary commitment on an outpatient basis. This is being done by states in an effort to prevent rehospitalization simply because it costs the state so much money to have people in the state mental hospital, and by forcing medication, they can actually reduce readmission rates. And that actually works. That is, keeping people on medication does in fact work, whether it's for schizophrenia or high blood pressure or cholesterol. There's a lot of issues involved in this in terms of personal freedom and civil liberty that needs to be addressed by other people. We're going to be going to break. After the break, we'll pick up with Dr. Rahm, and callers, the number 480-643-5428. You're listening to Dr. K on Psychiatry Ask the Expert.
Real Life Solutions, Voice America Health and Wellness.
To perform at your maximum potential, you need to have all aspects of your life working properly. On Mind, Brain, and Body, Dr. Michael John Kell will bring you honest, open discussions concerning your physical, mental, and financial health. If you're ready to find purpose and meaning in your life, tune in to Mind, Brain, and Body every Friday at 8 a.m. Pacific. Mind, Brain, and Body on Voice America Health and Wellness. Radio dedicated to your health, wealth, wisdom, and purpose.
Videos de aprendizaje de inglés. Máxima calidad.
Nunca escucharás a alguien vendiendo educación en la calle, pero con programas familiares gratuitos sí puedes obtener la educación que necesitas. Llame al 1-877-326-5481 para información sobre programas gratuitos de educación familiar.
Mira, vengan aquí. Obtengo un mejor vocabulario en inglés garantizado.
El primer paso a una vida mejor. Un mensaje del National Center for Family Literacy y el Ad Council.
Achieve exceptional levels of health and fitness through integrating the very best in fitness, nutrition, and healing. Tune into Total Fitness with fitness, nutrition, and healing coaches Catherine Kerrigan and James Williams. Each week, get inspired to exercise, eat and rest in harmony with your body's needs, and take advantage of effective natural healing methods with in-depth cutting-edge information and advice. Get fit, get healthy, get motivated, and get real with Total Fitness, broadcasting every Friday at 7 a.m. on Voice America Health and Wellness.
Parents, did you know that high school dropouts make 42% less than graduates? Someone will have to make up that difference, and chances are, that will be you. That means paying 42% of their groceries.
Ooh, more candy.
42% of their dentist bills.
No more candy.
Even 42% of their therapy sessions.
It's all my dad's fault.
Save your money. Encourage your kids to stay in school. For help and advice, call 877-FORA-KID. A message from the U.S. Army and the Ad Council.
Are you tired of being tired? Are you sick of sitting around while life passes you by? You can get back on track by tuning in to Voice America Health and Wellness every Monday at 12 p.m. Pacific Time. For Attracting Abundance, the Energy of Success with Carol Look. Attracting Abundance is the program that empowers you to finally break through your limiting beliefs and blocks and shows you how to succeed in all areas of your life, from improved financial abundance, health and weight problems, as well as your relationships. Don't wait another week to be joyful. Listen to Attracting Abundance, the Energy of Success with Carol Look this Monday at 12 p.m. Pacific Time right here on Voice America Health and Wellness.
A fresh look at today's health. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Welcome back to Psychiatry Ask the Expert. If you have a question or comment, dial toll free at 1-866-369-3742. Now back to the show. Here's Dr. Kaye.
Hi, this is Jay Birch, not Dr. Kaye, and you're back with Psychiatry Ask the Expert. Again, we're reminding our listeners that the call-in number this evening is 480-643-5428. I'm here at Neil Kaye's office and Dr. Kaye's office with Dr. Ranga Ram, who is our guest this evening, an expert in schizophrenia. And we'd like to get Dr. Ram in on our discussion. Ranga, would you like to comment on either of the two articles that I had from the Wall Street Journal discussing different aspects of the treatment of schizophrenia?
Thank you very much, Jay. I thought that those two articles were very pertinent articles to the care of patients with schizophrenia. The first article was the one that appeared in Newsweek that I'd like to talk about, where the author talks about the experiences of his brother who had a very severe form of the mental illness. And the patient was, his brother, who was a patient, was in a hospital for nearly 40 years getting treatment. And during the course of the treatment, began to develop a relationship with a case manager who was very instrumental in getting the patient much better, in addition to the modern medication the patient was in. And when the case manager was transferred due to some budgetary concern or other administrative reason, the patient relapsed with the full resurgence of symptoms, although he was still taking the new atypical antipsychotic medications, which had done very well for him. And that makes the case in point that assertive case management is a form of treatment for schizophrenia that has proven to be very effective. And the case manager establishes a personal one-on-one relationship with the patient and provides usually a series of supports for the patient. And the typical supports would include, but not limited to, just the following. To give you an example, a case manager might befriend the patient, maybe visiting the patient several times a week, helps the patient budget for and acquire through shopping and other means all of the things that they may need, ensure that there's some relationship with the landlord, that the bills are paid, electricity, phone calls, rent, and so on. So the patient has a stable home. Usually transportation or learning to use public transportation would be a support system provided for the patient by the case manager. Think of all these patients who've been living for years and years in institutions while society has changed remarkably in the last 30 years. There's a great deal of relearning for them to learn to live back in the community, and that's what the case managers provide. And therefore, that's a very critical treatment objective of schizophrenia in the modern day.
I think the other thing wrong about the case manager that does come out in this article is that the case manager gave the patient hope and believed in the patient and consistently gave the patient the message that they could get better and that they could change. And for all of us as clinician healers, whether you're a PhD or an MD or a DO or an LCSW or an LPC or whatever, I think that message of hope is just so important for us to give. And it's harder and harder for doctors to give it in the managed care world where you get, you know, 3 minutes per patient. But for all of us to give patients the message of hope, I can't stress how important that is. I think family members need to give that to their loved ones as well.
That, Neil, you bring up a great point because, you know, we're looking at this as here's a patient in a state institution as if it's the state's now responsibility for this person's care, support, and recovery. It's interesting that it's the patient's brother who's writing the article, that the brother has had this ongoing continuing relationship over a 40-year period of time. And as we've kind of researched the author, we know that he's written other books about mental illness based on his experience with his brother. How important is family support? Can family support supplement or maybe even replace what the state can do?
Case managers will work with families. Recovery-oriented treatment includes the following premises. One, you will work with families. The patient's strengths are taken into account as well as the deficits. The patient's potential for re-engaging in some kind of a work or work-like setting is a very important step. So there are a number of needs that the patient will have that a case manager tries to meet, and some of these needs are actually directed by the patient in their own recovery. And the case manager tries to provide an environment where these things are done.
Okay, Ranga, we've kind of gotten the cart before the horse a little bit. Would you take time right now and give our audience a description of the disease, the mental illness, schizophrenia?
Certainly. Schizophrenia is a brain disease. As I mentioned, 1% of American population suffers from a lifetime chance of getting the disease of schizophrenia. That would mean at any given time we have about 2.5 million people suffering from this disease. The characteristic symptoms of the disease fall into several categories. The most common symptoms that are known are patients who are hearing voices or having delusions. The classic presentation would be somebody that you might see on the streets walking, mumbling to themselves, not wearing adequately clean clothes, maybe wearing several layers of clothing, somewhat disheveled and malodorous, not taking adequate care of themselves. That would be one of the stereotypical thoughts that anyone would have when they're thinking of someone with schizophrenia. The other set of symptoms that are embedded in this description is the negative symptoms or functions that the person has lost, which is also a significant part of schizophrenia. Patients with schizophrenia have lost their ability to express and show their emotions, may even have lost their ability to feel emotions, may have lost their ability to show the initiative and drive needed to shower, shave, and dress themselves every day. There are a number of functions, including even their ability to pay attention, that may be lost in schizophrenia, and that would impact on their ability to think clearly. Disorganized thought will be manifested by their disorganized speech. Their disorganized behavior is also reflecting parts of their brain that have suffered from the effects of the illness, and therefore there is a great deal of chaos in the way the person with schizophrenia presents to the average person who is looking at them from the outside.
Now, Ron, we hear about paranoid schizophrenia. What's the paranoid stuff?
Paranoid is the delusional stuff, and most often patients with schizophrenia may have thoughts that people are talking about them. They may think that they are getting special messages from the television or the radio. They may think that the government is after them, that the FBI is following them, that people have some malevolent or bad intention towards them and are going to do them some harm.
So paranoia might also be somewhat persecutory in nature. They feel people are out to get them. You also mentioned positive and negative symptoms. Can you explain them and why one is more important than the other?
Positive symptoms are new symptoms that have emerged after the person has become ill with schizophrenia, such as hearing voices or even seeing visions that can occur rarely. Paranoid symptoms are positive symptoms because they occur newly after the illness has started. Negative symptoms refers to those functions that all of us take for granted in everyday life, such as taking care of oneself, grooming, personal appearance, and so on. And these are all lost because the patient has lost their ability to carry them out when they are very ill with schizophrenia.
Now, which of these is more important, the hearing the voices or the false beliefs of a delusion or the negative stuff, the not taking care of yourself and not bathing?
I would say that it's both these symptoms are important in assessing someone with schizophrenia. The positive symptoms generally were amenable to the older medications. Patients who got the older medications such as Thorazine or Haldol seemed to get their voices were under good control, their delusions went away, but their negative symptoms actually got worse. The Thorazine shuffle is a way in which people described a patient who was on these older meds who was even more slowed down, that they could not walk like a normal person, but they were very, very slow. So negative symptoms with the older medications actually got worse. With the newer medications, which began coming into the market since 1988 when clozapine was introduced, and then there was risperidol and Zyprexa, Seroquel, Geodon, and Abilify, all of these have come out since then. These seem to help both the positive symptoms, they keep them under control, and the negative symptoms, they seem to keep them under control as well. So the patient seems to improve, and therefore the patient can get regular jobs, can go and work in places where they never did before.
Ranga, you bring up a couple things we need to sort of clarify, at least maybe just for me. You talked about the emergence of symptoms. I've been reading recently that there's some school of thought that says that there might be a prodrome, if you will, of schizophrenia. You know, is that true? And then also give us some idea about, is this a disease primarily of males versus females or females versus males, and about what age group is generally affected by schizophrenia?
Schizophrenia is predominantly an illness that begins to occur at a younger age group of around 20 years. Men seem to have an earlier onset than women, but by the time patients are about 45 to 50 years old, the gender difference seems to disappear, although there may be a slightly excess involvement of men in the illness of schizophrenia. What was the other question, Jay?
Is there a prodrome?
The prodrome is a phase during which the negative symptoms, the isolation, the withdrawal, the inability to engage in everyday activities, maybe the person ends up losing their job and is not their usual self. That may be the actual beginning of the illness before the hallucinations and delusions become clear.
Yeah, there's actually something also that we talk about. There's a schizotypal personality, a schizoid personality, which we used to think did not really progress into full-blown schizophrenia. More recently, we're starting to rethink that, and there actually does seem to be a transition for a fair number of people from a more personality disorder kind of presentation or a milder presentation into the full-blown symptom presentation that we see, so that there does seem to be some progression that we are starting to see as we're starting to study this in a longitudinal fashion much better.
So might these things actually take place in the early teenage years, or how long would this...
Yeah, I think that we see sometimes in teenagers, and again, boys more than girls may present as young as late teens. Fairly common presentation, freshman in college, first time away from home, new stressors, and that acts sort of as an environmental trigger for an underlying biological condition for things to spin out of control. And it's not uncommon for us to see it in early college years, particularly in the younger men. We're going to be going to break in just a moment. We'll be returning after break with Dr. Rahm and some more questions on schizophrenia. Callers, remember our number tonight, 480-643-5428. You're with Dr. Kaye, Jay Birch, and Dr. Rahm on Psychiatry as the Expert.
Opinions, options, answers. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Stay mentally, physically, and emotionally fit with Younger Every Day. Hosted by Dr. Bob Payson. Broadcast every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific Time, 1 p.m. Eastern Time on the Voice America Health and Wellness Channel.
Younger Every Day will offer you alternative solutions for a variety of health issues, all backed by clinical, scientific, and medical data. Dr. Payson and other expert guests will inform and inspire people of all ages to look and feel better. Younger Every Day. Think clear, feel strong, grow younger. With Dr. Bob Payson, right here on Voice America Health and Wellness.
Women, do you feel that you're too old to be active, too old to be beautiful, too old to have fun, or too old to be fabulous? Well, if that's what you think, then there's good news for you. You're wrong. Tune in to Voice America every Wednesday at 8 a.m. Pacific Standard Time for Aging Outside the Box. Fabulous Women Over 50 with Shirley Mitchell. Aging Outside the Box is a fabulous, fun program that gives you every reason to feel greater than you ever have. Host Shirley Mitchell and O.E. Cruiser Small will cover phenomenal topics such as women's issues, health, diet, exercise, nutrition, faith, travel, and many other concerns for women of all ages. Feel young, feel smart, and feel fabulous by tuning in to Aging Outside the Box. Fabulous Women Over 50 with Shirley Mitchell every Wednesday at 8 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, right here on VoiceAmerica.com.
Tired of life working out the exact same no matter how much you try to change it? It's time to get a new perspective. Perspectives, alternatives for living life better, with host Margie Sugarman, clears the cobwebs of confusion and offers practical solutions to life's issues. Broadcasting every Wednesday at 4 p.m. Pacific on the Voice America Health and Wellness Channel, clinical social worker and psychotherapist Margie Sugarman is here so you can make the right physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual choices for your life. Right here on the Voice America Health and Wellness Channel.
Perform at your maximum potential, you need to have all aspects of your life working properly. On Mind, Brain, and Body, Dr. Michael John Kell will bring you honest, open discussions concerning your physical, mental, and financial health. If you're ready to find purpose and meaning in your life, tune in to Mind, Brain, and Body every Friday at 8 a.m. Pacific. Mind, Brain, and Body on Voice America Health and Wellness. Radio dedicated to your health, wealth, wisdom, and purpose.
Step into a healthier you. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Welcome back to Psychiatry Ask the Expert. If you have a question or comment, dial toll free at 1-866-369-3742. Now back to the show. Here's Dr. Kaye.
Welcome back to Psychiatry Ask the Expert with Dr. Kaye. Actually, we've got a couple callers on the line, so we're going to go to Mary Jo from Ohio first. Welcome, Mary Jo. Can you hear us?
I can, yes. Thank you. I wanted to comment. I have a question for the doctor, Dr. M, and I also have a comment that what you're mentioning about family I think is so important. My son was diagnosed with schizophrenia 14 years ago, and he's, you know, had the support of his family, and we've seen him improve all along the way. And I wanted to say that once I went to an appointment with David, and the doctor that he had at the time said to him, David, I admire you. And he looked real puzzled, and he said, me? And she said, yes, because it takes, we take for granted. We get up, we dress, we go about our day, and we take for granted that that's just what you do. But you get up, and you go through a struggle to get through your day, and yet you keep going. And it made such a difference in his life after that, like someone admired him and that, what he was doing just by coping with his illness was a big deal. And I want to ask the question then in relation to family. He's very comfortable around his family. He has three sisters and a brother, but he doesn't want to reach out socially to anyone else. So I wonder how we can encourage that, and how important is it, or can he be okay just with relating to his family? He lives with us also. So I guess I'll hang up and let you answer.
Thank you very much, Mary Jo. It's always very important that people share personal stories of their own family members. It helps in two ways. It helps minimize the stigma around mental illness and helps normalize the experience of people with schizophrenia to the extent that society has so many unanswered questions about who they are and where they come from, and it's very helpful to know that. You talk about this, and I think that her comment was very important to say that he was someone that who could be admired for being able to deal with the burden of the illness in the way he was doing at the time that she made the comment. So both of those are very important. The question about interaction socially, social interactions may be diminished as part of the temperament or personality of a person with schizophrenia even before the illness begins. Now, I would say, in answer to your question, whether he needs to have a social interaction, social interactions do help patients. Going to a psychosocial rehabilitation program, a program where they are meeting with other people and beginning to have a kind of social life, may be helpful. But if that is not something that David wants, there is no reason to make him choose something he does not want. And I would say that this should be dealt with just almost as we are dealing with this with our own kids who do not have schizophrenia as we are bringing them up. If they are temperamentally able to go out and meet people, that's wonderful. They are not so inclined, we encourage them to do so. And they still do not like that experience, and there's a good reason why they don't want to do it, then that's all right as well. I think schizophrenics are no different from most people.
Yeah, I think that's true, Rob. I think one of the other factors that comes in is that patients with schizophrenia, if they are not at the same stage in life where some of their peers are, have a degree of shame that limits them from going out socially because they're not working, they're not doing some of the things that other people that are so, who would normally be their peers are doing, and that shame issue serves to inhibit them and keep them from going out and being involved where they might be able to involve themselves with family who are unconditionally loving and accepting and where they don't feel that shame. So I think it's worth exploring the issue of shame about this with David and seeing what he does or doesn't feel comfortable with. But I certainly agree with Dr. Rahman that if he's comfortable without being real social, well, that's okay. His comfort is what's most important, and I don't think it helps to force people to live in a way that doesn't really make sense for them. I think Mary Jo actually hang up. If she didn't, I hope we answered your question. If not, you're allowed a follow-up. And if you're not on the line, I think we're going to go over to Mary. We're going to Stephanie from New York is our next caller. Stephanie, are you with us?
Hi, yes, I am.
Hi. Welcome. Ask away.
Hi. I have a question really about, I guess, diagnosis. You sort of talk about schizophrenia and hearing voices and delusions kind of out of touch with reality as the rest of us see it. And yet people with bipolar disorder, when they're manic, also seem to be out of touch with reality, you know, think they can do bizarre and unusual things like fly or, you know, other unreal things. How do you tell the difference between someone who's manic and bipolar and manic versus schizophrenic?
That's an excellent question. There was a tendency to overdiagnose schizophrenia in the United States compared to, say, let's say, the UK in the 1960s because of the similar kinds of questions that you ask. If psychotic symptoms, as they are referred to, hearing voices and having delusions, are common to both bipolar disorder and schizophrenia, what sets them apart? The core problem in bipolar disorder is the mood goes up or down. The patient may have an elated mood, maybe euphoric, and at the time that they have the mood disturbance, they also experience psychotic symptoms. On the other hand, during depression, the patient may have a very depressed mood, and during the mood disturbance, they also have psychotic symptoms that may have, like hallucinations that may tell them that they are not worth anything or to kill themselves or say that people are saying negative things about them. But those symptoms go away when the mood becomes normal. That is the core difference between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. In fact, there is an illness known as schizoaffective disorder where there may be a mixture of schizophrenia-type symptoms which occur without mood disturbance and bipolar symptoms which may occur with psychotic symptoms at other times, and these two sort of co-occur. The classic difference between schizoaffective disorder and schizophrenia is that patients with schizophrenia will have psychotic symptoms with absolutely no mood disturbance. Schizoaffective patients may have psychotic symptoms sometimes, but not most of the time. It's a very small part of the total duration of illness over a period of years. patients with bipolar disorder or major depression with psychotic symptoms will have psychotic symptoms only when they have mood symptoms. So that's how we separate the three disorders.
I think that's a nice summary, Ron. Let me also throw in the idea that the content or quality of the delusions, the false beliefs, are frequently different in schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. In bipolar disorder, they're more likely to be more grandiose, whereas, say, in schizophrenia, they're more commonly more paranoid in nature. Granted, there's some overlap, but that's one of the things that people will sometimes use to help distinguish between the two illnesses. Stephanie, did that answer your question?
Yes, that was very helpful. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you for calling in. Ranga, early on you talked about the disheveled person on the street, malodorous, not having changed their clothes, and talking to themselves. And this is kind of a frightening vision that you paint. A lot of us have seen these people out on the street, and I think a lot of callers wonder, are patients with schizophrenia more dangerous or violent to a society at large? And is that, in fact, why people like Fuller Torrey say we ought to force them to get treatment or lock them up? What's that all about? Because I think that's really a big issue.
It's a very complicated question, and I will try to set apart some of the things. As a group, patients with schizophrenia are no more violent than the general population. But there are subgroups which are problematic. Patients who are not in treatment, who are not taking any medications, tend to act on their beliefs, their paranoid delusions, or their hallucinations, and therefore may commit violent crimes. So an untreated patient with schizophrenia is probably likely to be more violent than someone who is in treatment. When someone is in treatment, their risk of violence is about the same as general population. The second aspect that increases the risk of violence is that there is a very high tendency of patients with schizophrenia to abuse drugs, drugs such as cocaine and other drugs that they may use. Illegal substances tend to produce a worsening of their psychosis as well as tend to make them more violent. Whether this is motivated behavior to get money to use the drugs or a result of psychotic symptoms that emerge as a result of drug use. Drug use, illicit drug use without medications, tend to destabilize the patients and increase the risk for violence. Fuller Torrey and others have advocated for a committed or involuntary treatment of patients in an outpatient setting. The reason they did this is because institutional settings where traditionally patients were treated on an involuntary basis have begun to shut their doors, and more patients with schizophrenia are being treated out in the community. And if they go off their medications, there is a higher risk for potentially dangerous behavior by these patients. Therefore, about 41 states have on their statutes some type of an outpatient commitment law. And this has brought in several 100,000 patients across the country into treatment. And that has benefited them to some extent.
Okay, that's very helpful. So basically, not more dangerous if you're mentally ill, unless you're not on medications or you're using drugs and alcohol, meaning illicit substances, at the same time. I point out before we go to break that there is one particular drug I want to mention, and that's PCP, Angel Dust, which actually can produce a psychosis that pretty much mimics schizophrenia. And for clinicians in the emergency room setting or psychiatrists, it's very hard to distinguish PCP psychosis from true schizophrenia. And in fact, some of us think it may PCP use may actually cause permanent schizophrenia to develop. A lot of PCP is laced into marijuana these days. You really want to stay away from illegal drugs for both you and your kids. We're going to go to break and continue with Dr. Rom after break. Psychiatry Ask the Expert with Dr. Kaye. Thanks.
Helping you make informed decisions for your life. This is Voice America Health and Wellness.
Hey, how you doing? Educational videos, top quality, right here.
You'll never hear anyone selling education on the street. But with free family learning programs, you can get the education you need. Call 1-877-FAMLIT1 for information on free learning programs. 1-877-FAMLIT1.
Check it out. You need a GED right here, guaranteed, ma. Come on, check it out.
Free family learning program from the National Center for Family Literacy. Brought to you by the National Center for Family Literacy and the Ad Council.
When you combine energy secrets from ancient China and the latest breakthroughs in medicinal science, you get power healing with Dr. Shah. Heard every Friday at 5 p.m. Pacific Time on Voice America Health and Wellness. Each week, Dr. Shah will bring you another step closer to the expanding world of body space medicine. You will quickly learn and appreciate how power healing is a perfect alternative to hospitals and expensive drugs. Take a step beyond modern medicine every Friday at 5 p.m. Pacific Time with Dr. Shah on Power Healing, right here on Voice America Health and Wellness.
Growing Up in America explores the challenges, risks, benefits, and differences this generation of children face each day. Hosted by veteran pediatric emergency physician and father of four, Dr. Charles Nzika, this show is for parents, teens, and children. It crosses each generation. By exploring the unique aspects of matriculation within this current generation, we hope to find answers and ways of optimizing this experience for today's generation. Growing Up in America with Dr. Charles Nzika broadcasts each Tuesday at 2 p.m. Pacific, 5 p.m. Eastern, on the Voice America Health and Wellness Channel.
Do you know how health insurance is supposed to work and why some believe it's not working correctly? To find realities behind the myths, log on each Thursday at 1 o'clock Pacific Standard Time to Voice America Health and Wellness for Inside Health Insurance in America with Sharon Ault. Every show will peel back another layer of how health insurance has, could, and should work in America to benefit employers, employees, insured, and uninsured. You will also hear from industry insiders and high-ranking government officials, so join us every Thursday at 1 o'clock Pacific Standard Time for Inside Health Insurance in America, right here on Voice America Health and Wellness.
Increase the quality of your life by decreasing the chances of disease and disability. Listen to Age Management Medicine in the 21st Century every Wednesday at 1 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Eastern. On the show, host Dr. Harvey S. Bartnoff will discuss how to optimize your health span through hormone therapy, preventative medicine, proper nutrition, and more. Improve your vitality. Enjoy your life. Listen to Age Management Medicine in the 21st Century with Dr. Harvey S. Bartnoff every Wednesday at 1 p.m. Pacific and 4 p.m. Eastern, right here on Voice America Health and Wellness.
Opinions, options, answers. Voice America Health and Wellness.
Welcome back to Psychiatry Ask the Expert. If you have a question or comment, dial toll free at 1-866-369-3742. Now back to the show. Here's Dr. Kaye.
Welcome back to Psychiatry Ask the Expert. This is Jay Birch. Just to remind you one more time, the call-in number this evening is 480-643-5428. I'm here with Dr. Neil Kaye and Dr. Ranga Ram. We're discussing schizophrenia this evening. Ranga, we've almost completely covered the description of schizophrenia. We've talked about schizoaffective disorder and differentiating schizophrenia from bipolar disorder. Let's just take one more step down this road to make sure I completely understand what we're talking about. Isn't schizophrenia a lot like multiple personality disorder? Is it like having a split personality or not really?
Well, it's a common misperception that schizophrenia refers to split personality. It comes from our understanding of the word schizo means split, and phrenia refers to the mind. But really, the illness is very different from multiple personality, except in the hands of people like Jay Leno, as Dr. Kaye often says, there's nothing similar in the two illnesses of schizophrenia and multiple personality disorder. Patients with schizophrenia have one personality, but they experience lots of breaks with reality, such as hallucinations and delusions. Patients with multiple personality may have actually different names for the different personalities that they carry.
Okay. Now, in your description of the disease and our discussion a little bit about the prodrome, it seems like someone is experiencing symptoms or indications of schizophrenia for some time leading up to what we would call the first schizophrenic break. Is this usually when the patient and the psychiatrist meet, and if so, how does that happen, and what goes on during that first session or first meeting with a psychiatrist?
Most patients, even in modern day America seem to go through a period of about, on average, 3 years before they get to see a psychiatrist with schizophrenia. This data is from the Suffolk County Mental Health Project, which picked up every patient who had their first psychotic break on Long Island in the eastern half called the Suffolk County, and they were brought in for treatment through an inpatient setting, probably through an emergency room or an inpatient setting. And most of the patients with schizophrenia, their first treatment experience is probably in an inpatient setting. It's very rare, only about 20% of patients with schizophrenia get diagnosed in what is called an office-based practice. 80% of them end up coming in through an inpatient.
Well, get into treatment if we can, as we're coming to the last part of the show here. Talk about some of the medications. What are some of the key things to know, some of the differences, some of the highlights? You mentioned, I think, 5 antipsychotics as the newer ones before. Give us a quick rundown, if you would.
The older medications began to be used since 1950. The first one was Thorazine. Probably the best-known one is Haldol. These medications just blocked the dopamine receptors alone and produced some relief from psychotic symptoms such as hallucinations and delusions, but produced a lot of side effects. The more modern medications, which are called atypical antipsychotics, seem to be affecting both the dopamine and serotonin receptors, and they tend to block them. Most of the medications that work in this category produce less of the muscle rigidity and the shuffle, which was known to be common with the Thorazine and Haldol type of medication.
As evidenced in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest?
Exactly. The symptoms were the side effects were very carefully portrayed, and in fact, psychiatry got quite a bit of a bad reputation because of the side effects of the older medications. The newer medications are clearly superior. The side effects are much less in terms of the muscle rigidity, but no medication is safe, and many of the newer medications bring their own set of new side effects, which could be a physical problem, weight gain, and so on. There are clearly some medications just superior to others in not having weight gain. For instance, the newest two on the market, Abilify and Geardon, are said to be two medications that do not cause too much of side effects of weight gain. So the superiority of the newer medications, not only do they work better, they produce less side effects.
Where does a drug like clozapine or Clozaril fit into this?
Clozaril was the first one which set this whole revolution of bringing in new medications to the market. Clozaril is considered as the treatment for schizophrenia, which helps with treatment-resistant schizophrenia. Patients who have failed 2 or more antipsychotic medications will still be helped with Clozaril. The second indication that Clozaril is so much superior is that patients with schizophrenia commit suicide at a very high rate, and Clozaril prevents suicidal ideation and suicide attempts in patients with schizophrenia. It's very important to know that 1 in 10 patients with schizophrenia still might make a fatal suicide attempt.
Why is Clozaril held back then?
Clozaril is held back because of the numerous side effects associated with it. One of those side effects is a sudden drop in white cell count called agranulocytosis, which could be fatal. So the FDA had ruled that every week people must get their white cell counts monitored in order to be on Clozaril. Now this monitoring has actually been reduced after 10 to 15 years, and patients who have been on Clozaril for more than 1 year can actually be monitored once a month, according to the most recent FDA notice that was released in January of 2006.
All right, you talked a little bit about monitoring with Clozaril and some of these side effects. In the newer drug class, we've got side effects as well as we did in the older one. Less movement disorder, less of the tardive dyskinesia, more of the metabolic syndrome that you talked about, weight gain issues. What are the monitoring guidelines? What should people expect to be doing to monitor all of the new medication?
When a patient is being started on a new atypical antipsychotic, the psychiatrist should discuss with the patient the issues around weight gain, the possibility of developing diabetes, and the possibility of developing high cholesterol, which has got implications for cardiac disease. The patient's family history is a very important way to advise the psychiatrist and the patient as to the potential experience for the side effects that have been mentioned above. We also should measure the patient's weight at baseline and try to get a good measurement of what is called the BMI. Typically, fat which is maintained around the waist tends to be a very poor risk factor in terms of developing cardiac problems, as time goes on, and therefore one should pay attention to it. The APA, the American Psychiatric Association, along with the American Diabetes Association, came up with monitoring techniques which include measuring fasting blood sugar, getting a cholesterol level, certainly getting a weight, which is very easy to do, would be the way to start.
Okay, great. So we're going to get height, weight, girth, blood pressure, lipids, the fat, and our blood sugars on all of our patients, and try to teach them to exercise and diet. That really gets us into the take-home points for today's visit on Psychiatry Ask the Expert. We want patients to take medication the way it's prescribed, even if you're feeling better, in fact, especially if you're feeling better. The reason you're better is your medication and your treatment. No alcohol or street drugs. You got to refrain completely. This is an absolute. We're not going to get you better, and your meds won't work as well. Exercise, absolutely. We want you to be exercising 30 minutes a day, at least three times a week, and eating a healthy diet. Low-fat diet actually does help higher protein and be out there. And for all of our listeners and family members, if you or someone you know might be experiencing a mental illness or emotional problem, please help them find professional help while giving the family support and love that only friends and family can provide. Talk to doctors or friends to get referrals to people you can trust. Contact your local medical society or psychiatric or psychological association, or go online to one of the better websites. We recommend ADAA.org, HealthyMinds.org, NMHA.org, NAMI.org, and NIMH.org. Till next week, when we have Dr. Thomas Wynn talking about child psychiatry, Dr. Neil Kaye and Jay Birch, with thanks to Dr. Ranga Ram, our guest tonight on Psychiatry Ask the Expert. We'll see you next week.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening to Psychiatry Ask the Expert. To learn more about Dr. Kaye, visit courtpsychiatrist.com. Tune in next Tuesday for another hour of Psychiatry Ask the Expert with Dr. Neil Kaye.